Okay, welcome to Cram Session TV's continued coverage of the Microsoft Exam Syllabus 070-290, managing and maintaining a Microsoft Windows Server 2003 environment. This is part four, and we'll be looking at managing and maintaining the server environment itself. I think what I'll do is I'll hand over to Nicky, and he can continue with the overview and take us through this episode.
Okay, so as Nick said, this is part four of five, so hopefully you've seen the previous three to this, and we're just continuing on. And what we're looking at in this one, as Nick said, is managing and maintaining a server environment. There's nothing particularly tricky in this particular section. It's really just getting together some of the tools you've all probably used, and then, you know, putting them all together and understanding how to use them effectively. So the first off, just to run through what we're going to cover in this next sort of hour or so, is we're going to have a look at monitoring and analyzing events, so a bit of an event viewer. Also managing servers remotely. Mm-hmm. I mean, very rarely you're actually going to be sitting on the server when you want to administer it or maintain it. So we can use various things, like some of you might use computer management and connect remotely over the network, or you might have to use remote desktop. And again, the exam likes to test your knowledge to find out if you know what the right tool is to use. And it's very, very straightforward. If I could just give you an example, you can't remote defrag. We saw that in some of the previous Cram sessions.
Yeah.
So in order to defrag a server, you would have to remote desktop into
it. Yeah, you have to get onto the machine itself.
So a lot of this is common sense stuff. So let's all pull it together. Once we had a look at that, we're just going to move on and have a look at disk quotas. And we haven't had a look at disk quotas at all as yet in any of the ITIdiots ones. Mainly because, again, not many people use them. I would say some people do use them, but we'll have a look at the concept of disk quotering, how you can troubleshoot it. Mm-hmm. Also then looking at print queues, and then turning our attention back to the performance monitor and having a look at some specific counters that will help us give us an idea on our server health, for example, finding out if it's suffering from any bottlenecks due to a lack of physical memory, hard disk subsystem is too slow. And basically what we're doing is we're looking at these key points, looking at memory objects, network objects, processor objects and disk objects.
Okay.
And that's really this part.
Okay, sounds good. Okay. Let's dig straight in.
Okay, so we're going to start off by looking at some remote administration. Let me just set the scene what I've got in front of me. So what I've got is I've got just a Windows XP machine sitting in front of me. And behind the scenes, what we've got is we've got two servers. You've seen them in the previous Cram session. We've got Cram DMC01, which is a domain controller.
Yes.
And we've got Cram SRV01, which is just a server.
Yep.
It's in the domain, semi as a workstation. So this will give me the benefits of showing you how I can remotely administer the server from a workstation, which most people do. So what I'm going to do is start off with some of the basic tools we've got. So one of the first ones I'm going to go through is computer management. Mm-hmm. And I'm a great fan of computer management. And to be honest, I'm always embarrassed because when I first saw it, I never really saw the big picture. But computer management, if we just load it up, it's really just an MMC. And we can see inside this MMC, we've got lots of tools which enable us to, you know, check on the health and to troubleshoot. So, you know, Event Viewer, you're all probably aware of. We've got application logs, system logs, and security logs. And it's probably worth just defining some of these logs at this point whilst we're here. The main logs, I would say, on your server are going to be system, security, and application.
Yeah.
The other logs that you can see in here, Internet Explorer, Office, are brought around through applications.
Yeah.
So the operating system would generally log events into the system log. So if you've got any problems, like you've all probably seen the error message that pops up that says one or more services failed to start during startup.
Yeah.
So look straight into the system log to see what failed. And we can see already in here, there's an error. Okay, so this error occurred at 4:10, and this failed to load, and I'm not even sure what that device is. Okay, I'm running a slightly weird workstation here. It's running via boot camp and parallels. It doesn't really matter, but we've had a few service failures during the startup of it, and I think that's...
It shows the fact that they do occur and where to go and look for them, so that's quite useful.
Exactly. And another one we've got here, and this is a really interesting error, we've got an error to do with time, so time synchronization hasn't been occurring.
Another useful little one is the fact that you should be able to take that description and put it straight into Google as a search.
Exactly. I mean, you've got a little link in here, and it will actually, I think it will, yeah, send that across, and it will give you some information relating to that.
Yeah.
And this is totally interactive, so if anyone has found a solution for this, it should tie in.
Ah, okay, that's even better then.
If you get cool things like MOM actually, Microsoft Operation Manager, that actually analyses the events and says, okay, you've got a memory problem there, you've got a disk issue there, and ties those two together and will actually give you, or translate it into something English.
Into something human.
Exactly, yeah. So that's the system log on there. Okay. So if we look at the application log, this is when you'll see applications that you've installed, such as, I mean, Office, but also your back office applications like SQL Server and Exchange. So when you install those back office applications, you probably would want to increase the size of your application log.
Okay.
And you can do that very, very simply by going into the properties of it, and you can see the information in there.
Yeah.
Now, when this fills up to 512K, what's going to happen? It's going to overwrite events older than 7 days.
Okay, so it's a rolling log.
It's a rolling log. Now, you've got to have a look at this one because, you know, if it gets to 512K and it's only 3 days, what's going to happen? Effectively, you won't be logging the next 4 days' worth of events.
Sure.
Until they're 7 days old. Now, of course, from a security logging point of view, that's not so good.
That's very bad.
So what you might want to do is, again, this very much depends on the use of your server. You might say, I don't really care, just overwrite as needed. And what we'll do is we'll give it 16 gig or 16, you know, meg, something like that.
Sure.
And that way you're keeping the last 16 megabytes. Or you can say, you know, let's make it 16 megabytes, but I'm going to have a manual procedure that someone goes in there, archives off these logs safely because they're important. I keep them.
Okay, so that would be a documented step.
Exactly, yeah, that would be some kind of written procedure. Right, the other nice thing that we can do in Event Viewer, and it's worth just having a look in here, we can filter. So I can say, just show me warnings and errors. Okay, so I can now see all the warnings and errors that have actually occurred. And we can see there's an application error. Let's just have a quick look at this. And this happened, and we can tell exactly what this is. This is when Nick and myself were installing the screen capture software.
Oh, that's right.
And it crashed running under Parallels, and this is telling us that our recorder has failed. Doesn't really tell us why, but it's told us it's failed. So that's looking at the application log. Security log contains your audited information. So you might decide you want to audit people creating Active Directory objects, accessing files, you know, printing to printers, etc.
Yeah.
But that's more of a topic of, you know, actually using the resources. What we're looking at is just gaining information using tools at the moment. So we're not specifically going down into any area.
And that's not necessary for the exam?
Not this one. You're looking at using tools.
Yep.
Really. So if we look at computer management, look up the top, I've connected to my local machine. This is showing me everything that's local. What I want to do is I want to connect across to my server.
Mm-hmm.
So I can right click on the top and say connect to another computer. And I go to, not IHQ, Cram SRV01. And that's the other server we've got running in the back. And it will connect up over and show us the computer management of that machine, I hope. Now, I've logged onto the domain as an administrator, mm-hmm. as a domain administrator, so the account that I'm currently logged onto the domain has got permissions to access that server.
Okay.
And you can see it's actually popped in now.
Gone straight in.
But in a real-life network, what you might decide to do, I mean, the fact that I've logged on Interactive as administrator is pretty much a no-go nowadays.
Yeah.
You log on as a standard user account,
yeah.
So I have two accounts, and then I would use the run as command on Computer Manager, yeah. And run that as an administrator. So this is pretty cool. You know, I'm connected to the server and I can have a look at the event view on that server. You know, and this is often something I do for, you know, things like auditing, and we can have a look at what went on that server. And of course it's running a little bit slower because it is accessing across the network. Okay. So we can see the applications pop through there. Right, let's continue down computer management. Let's have a look at shared folders. And this is really nice because this is showing me all the shared folders we've got on that server, Cram SRV01. Now what I could do is I can actually create another share on that machine, you know, from this remote location.
Mm-hmm.
So let's create a new file share on that machine. And the name of it is, let's just call it Cram. Oops, sorry, the folder to share on that server first. And I'm just going to go to stuff here. So that was looking at the local machine. And we share it as stuff. Share description, I'm not going to bother with. Click on next. And we say all users have got read-only access. This is just a little wizard that's popping me through. So let's just say administrators have full access. Other users have read-only access. Let's go with that. And that's basically setting up your share and NTFS permissions. Again, I expect that you guys probably are aware of that, and what we're doing is we're just showing in this Cram session the tools, the different ways of doing it, but permissions,
yeah.
Hopefully you guys are fairly familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
So now what I'm going to do, on the workstation, I'm just going to go to Start Run, and I'm going to say, show me the resources on Cram SRV01, and what we should see is a share there called Stuff.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's creating a remote share. So I could do that without interactively logging onto that machine. The other nice thing you can see in here, you can see the sessions on that machine, who's actually currently connected to it. So I can see administrator from a machine called Pumra, which is this workstation here, is currently connected to it. Okay, so that could be useful if you wanted to shut a server down. Let's find out if someone is connected to it.
Yeah.
What I could do is kick them off, do a closed session on that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what would probably happen is if that user is using Windows XP, Windows XP actually reconnects up in the background, so you'll see that session come back again.
Oh, okay. It does it seamlessly in the background.
Yeah. Open files, what's currently open? So we've got DFS is currently open for read access. But again, because this is not a real server, it's not really showing me anything exciting. So I'll tell you what I will do. Let's go to that machine. Let's go into stuff. And I'm just going to double click on GPMC. I just want to show us accessing a file, because it should now show us in here. If I do a refresh, so we can now see that GPMC is being accessed by administrator.
In a read-only capacity.
In a read-only. Because that's the current permissions I'm using to actually access that. It doesn't mean that's what I've got. It means that's currently what I'm using to access that. So, happy with that?
Yeah.
So, this is all good stuff. So, we can access... I'm doing all this remotely. I remember I've logged on interactively to my client machine here. Local users and groups. I can manipulate the local account database on that machine. Let's ignore that for a second. And likewise, I can do the same with groups.
So, it's quite powerful.
It is very powerful, yeah. Now, one thing, if I do connect over to a domain controller, you've got to remember, guys, that a domain controller doesn't have a local account database.
No.
So there'd be a red cross next to that if I was looking at a DC, because it's got a domain account database.
Okay, that makes sense.
Performance logs and alerts. We're going to come back to towards the end of this little section. It works in there. That's how we can find out the health of our machine, running performance logs and counter logs. So you might have seen it on some of the ITIdiots episodes. We can get it to do a net send or tell someone when our processor utilization is above a particular threshold.
Yeah, I think we did a whole episode on
that. We certainly did. It was a good one as well. Device manager. Now, with device manager, this one's kind of a little bit limited in functionality when you connect across the network, because it only gives you read-only access to device manager.
So you can't make any changes.
You can't make any changes. You can't update drivers, etc. But you know, it's useful enough just to find out what's going on that server. Okay, so we can see the screen has popped up and it said it is running in read-only mode because you're running on a remote machine. So again, that's something to remember. You want to manipulate drivers. You can't use computer management. You're going to need to use remote desktop to do that.
And that's the kind of question that they might throw your way.
Exactly, yeah. Into storage. Again, we've seen storage before. I'm going to go through the ones covered in the exam, which is really disk defragmentation. And notice this one. Oh, I can't defrag a remote drive. So again, we're looking at remote desktop to do that. Disk management, we can have a look at the partitions on that remote server. And this is feature complete. We can do anything with this. So I can create partitions. I can remove partitions.
Okay,
so I can connect to remote machines and look at the partition layout of that. And I can even create and delete partitions. In fact, I can do everything, you know, in terms of RAID that I could do remotely.
Okay.
Continuing on with computer management, remember this is just one tool, so just with this one tool you can do quite a lot of server administration just by, you know, logging on as a standard user and using this one tool with the run as command, and you can do quite a lot in here. Next one is services. So what services are currently running on that server?
Can you start and stop them remotely?
You can do, yeah. So you can restart services remotely, and that might be quite useful. Okay, so we can have a look in here and see what services are actually started. The state of them here, if it says automatic, it means it will start automatically when the server starts.
Yeah.
Manual, it's up to you to start it, or some other process can actually start it. And disabled is, obviously, it's disabled. So I often find, you know, when you get the one or more services failed to start, just search by startup or sort by startup here, because if it's listed to be automatic, it should have started. There are a few exceptions to the rule, and this is one of them, performance logs and alerts, because that will only start when it's needed.
Okay,
so that's absolutely fine that's stopped. So again, this could be useful. For example, changing the service account, you can go into here and you can change what this is currently running as.
Mm-hmm.
And again, do that all remotely. WMI control really isn't going to be relevant in this exam. So that's really the kind of things that you need to know for this exam, what you can do with computer management. Right. So what I'm going to do next is take you through what we can do using remote assistance.
Okay,
or remote assistance. Well, it's funny I should say this, actually, remote assistance, because in the syllabus they talk about administering servers with remote assistance. I don't think they mean that. I think they mean remote desktop. Okay, remote assistance is when someone's getting someone's in
got a problem.
They've got a panic and they have to ask for assistance.
Yeah,
and that's not probably likely to happen on your servers. You're much more likely to use remote desktop.
Yes,
a remote desktop is really what was terminal services for remote administration. That's what it was called in 2000. But it's now called remote desktop, and it is terminal services.
Yes.
So don't get worried when they ask, how can we configure remote desktop connections? You use it by running the terminal services management tool.
Gotcha.
Okay, and the terminal services configuration tool.
Also the tip.
So what I'm going to do is just, here's an RDP session to the server. So it's obvious that I've connected to this, and this is all set up to start with, but...
We also see it at the top there, don't we?
So yeah, so I can tell this is an RDP session. Let's have a look at how we set that up. If I go into properties of the server and click on remote here, we can see that remote desktop has been enabled.
Right.
And if I look at who's got access to this, I can see that no one's got specific access listed here. The only way people are getting access is because they're given specific rights to the server.
Gotcha.
And as you might well guess, administrators do have that right.
Yeah, administrator already has access.
Exactly.
There, yeah.
So what I want to do now is take you through the administration tool for this. So I'm going to pop into administration tools in here and go into terminal services manager first of all, and what I can see in here is I've got one person currently accessing this terminal server, and they're currently active and they're not idle, but that's their log on time. So who is this?
You.
Well, it's me actually. It's doing this session. So what we could do is just to show you, and I can right click and I can send them a message and say hi or Jai in this case, but we can see that's come straight back to me, so this obviously is me.
Yeah, disconnect yourself and it would kill the whole thing.
Exactly, so I won't be doing that one. Under sessions we can have a look at all the open sessions. That's currently me, administrator there. There isn't just an open session there which is set to be listening. And again, this is interesting because under remote administration mode, this is, it only allows two inbound connections plus the console.
Oh, okay.
With terminal services, if you run terminal services, not the remote desktop mode.
That's a licensing thing.
Yeah, it's a licensing thing. And you will see a lot more connections in there set to be listening. Because it prepares them ready for someone to connect in. Processes, we can find out all the current processes running on this, well, it's a terminal server effect, on this remote desktop machine. And again, more importantly, who's running them. So this might be quite useful if you've got a real-life terminal server. I mean, down on here we can see... Well, obviously running VMware, and that's, I think you guys realised that a few times. And we can see exactly what's running on that, or within that session on the terminal server.
Yep.
So VMware tools, and that's Windows Update. So it looks like it's doing a Windows Update at the moment. And that's it. So that's looking at the terminal services manager. So this one tool you can connect to as many terminal services or servers you wanted to. I don't really think there's anything else I can do from here.
No problem.
Okay, let's go to the other tool then, which is the terminal services configuration. And if I go into server settings on here, we've got various options in here, so we can do a little bit of configuration here. But this is the main tool you use to configure your remote desktop connections. And that's, you know, an easy one. Just make sure you get it in your head what's the difference between the terminal services configuration and the manager. Because
okay.
I've got to admit, I get them mixed up, and you probably saw me jutter there. So under server settings, we've got various options there. This can all be done with a group policy. In reality, it very probably will. This exam won't go that much into group policies, but don't be surprised if you do see it being mentioned if you send them there. If we go to the properties of the connection on this server, we can see things like the sessions on it. And with a terminal server connection, there's two types of disconnects we need to talk about. When I connect up to a terminal server, like I'm doing at the moment,
mm-hmm.
I can log off and the session is closed on the terminal server, or I can just disconnect.
Okay.
If I disconnect, it's still running on the server. It's just I don't get to the screen being passed back to me, and you know it's still running. It could be useful if you're running a script.
Yeah, something in the background.
Now, what you might want to do is you might want to configure the terminal services configure terminal services using the configuration tool to say, right, if a session's been disconnected for let's say 2 days,
mm-hmm.
probably they've forgotten about. So let's just close that session down, or you could choose to log that session out.
Bit of automatic tidying up or something.
Exactly. Now, that is done on the users as well. So we can go to the properties of every single user and give them each different settings.
Yeah.
But if we're looking at it purely for remote desktop, you'll probably be configuring it here because you don't really care who it is. Everyone's treated the same. You know, everyone shouldn't leave a disconnected session for more than 2 hours or something like that.
Okay.
So anything else underneath here that's examinable? Well, again, I'm not going through all the tabs here because a lot of these tabs, they're only really useful for terminal services. And remember, this is about remote desktop.
Yes.
Okay, which I know is using terminal services. Let's have a look at permissions. And this is one of the tabs I wanted to show you. So who's got user access to this? Oh, look, administrators have. And that's why the administrator's got access. Anyone else? This group. So there's a local group called Remote Desktop Users.
Right.
And if you look, that local group has got permissions. It's got user access and guest access.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, any member of the remote desktop local group on this server will be able to remote desktop into it. And that, again, is an important thing to realise for the exam because it never used to be that way. Basically, what there is, there's a right to log on using terminal services.
Mm-hmm.
That remote desktop users group has been given that right.
Okay.
Okay, so if you don't want to use this, you can actually go into the policy and give people individually that right. But they've put this group in here new in 2003 just to make things a bit easier.
Okay.
Just dump them in the group. That's what mm-hmm. you need to do. Do remember it's a local group. So therefore, if I wanted to manage multiple servers, you'd have to be in the remote desktop group of all of those servers.
Okay.
Yet again, that could easily be done with a group policy, very probably. Okay, so that's looking at... And because I'm running through remote desktop now, if I go to computer management, this is going to be focused on the local machine. You know, it's a nice thing, really. So if I go into things like disk management, it's a lot quicker. If I go into disk defragmentation, we can see we can actually do that there.
Yes.
Right, so moving on to the next section, what we're looking at is just monitoring file and print resources. So I'm going to look at something, an area which we haven't been before in the Cram session, or IT Idiots, in fact, and that's looking at disk quotas.
Okay.
Print queues, they're quite simplistic, to be honest. I will show you them, but it's quite easy to manage. It's just really a queue. You either delete objects in it or not if they're giving you problems. And then we'll have a look at monitoring server hardware for bottlenecks, and that's looking at some specific counters. So let's start off by looking at disk quotas. Now, disk quotering, I'm going to just go to one of the servers. Let's say Cram SRV01. This is going to be our file server. It's going to contain a share on it, which every user can use. So I'm just going to set that one up. Let's go in my C drive. Let's create a new folder in here.
We've got stuff that's already shared out.
Oh, we have, haven't we? Let's just go into public now. And of course, I could have done this via computer management. Which might be an edit. And I'm just going to go into the properties of public now and just get this shared out. Now, again, I'm going to be quite relaxed with the permissions because it's not a permissions podcast, so we can just give everyone full control just so we can get something working. But the problem now is I've got this share on my server. I've given all my users the ability to create files on that server. There's nothing really to stop a user accessing that SharePoint and filling it up.
No.
And, well, it shows that this server is incredibly bad design. Because look, the SharePoint's on the operating system drive.
It is.
So if we fill up that SharePoint, if we fill up that drive, then the operating system is probably going to come down.
Yeah.
So what could we do about that? Well, we could have designed our disks a bit better. That's one thing we could have done. Or we can enable disk quotering.
So we can limit it.
So we can actually limit it, yeah. So let's have a look at quotering. So what I'm going to do is go to the properties of the drive. Because when you enable quotering, you do it on a drive per drive basis. So if I go to the properties of my drive C, I've got a little quota tab there, and I'm just going to tick on enable quota management.
Ah, okay.
Now, when you enable quota management, I'm just going to apply that now. Again. So I enable quota management, and notice some of the other things that I haven't even ticked. There's the next box down says deny disk space to users exceeding quota limit. The next one is do not limit disk space. And I've got that ticked at the moment. So it's not in a limit. I've enabled quota management. What possible good is that going
to
be?
We'll allow you to at least monitor it, even if you're not limiting it.
Exactly. We can click on quota entries in here, and it will show us all the users who have got files on this and exactly how much space they're currently using. So again, this isn't a real server, so it's not very exciting looking at it here, but if we had lots of users logging on and storing files, you'll see them all listed in here.
So we can order those by the worst offenders.
Exactly, yeah, so it might be useful to find out how much space they're actually using. Now, no one's actually stored any files. I will get to store something on there, so we can see that in a second. So we can see that there. So quota limit, no limit, there's no warning level. So quotering might just be useful just casually to find out, you know, what's going on our servers. Now the quotering system works always on the uncompressed size. There's another exam point on there. So if you're using compression on your NTFS drives and you get a 100 meg file and it compresses down to 10 meg, you've used 100 meg of your quota.
Right.
Not 10, you've used 100. So it always works on the sort of uncompressed size on that one. Right, so I'm going to deny disk space to users exceeding the quota limit. Let's say, let's limit disk space to...
We want to make it quite small. 1 megabyte. Something.
And set warning level to 1 megabyte. So what's going to happen now, if someone connects up to that SharePoint, they're going to, and to do a directory listing of it, they'll see 2 megabytes available free disk space. And it will trigger a warning when there's 1 megabyte left.
Okay.
Now, what is this warning? You know what it is? It's nothing really. If you log an event, that's the only thing you can really do. But what you could do is you could use some other Microsoft tools, MOM or some kind of event coma, that will look at the event log, particularly looking for when that warning occurs.
And trigger something else
to happen. Right. But do remember, this might even be useful just loading up Event Viewer with a filtered list.
Mm-hmm.
Filtered list containing just the warning messages. And we can log an event when they go over their quota limit as well. Because you might want to deny them.
Yeah.
You might just want to say, right, that's your quota limit, but you can go over it if you like.
So good procedures for smaller companies where they don't necessarily need or want to put in the bigger tool.
Exactly, yeah. It's pretty good. Again, for small, it would fit in nicely with you.
Yes.
So you could find out, it might just be useful to find out that one of your users got, you know, 80 gigabytes worth of storage. Well, why? Oh, let's have a look at the quota entries. And you'll find out that they're all MP3,
yeah,
or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a few downsides or a few restrictions to the quotering system. That's it's done on a drive per drive basis.
Okay.
So if you had a drive and you had a public directory on there, a public SharePoint and a home directory in there, it's the combination of the storage space that they use which builds up their quota. Okay. And that can get a little bit tricky because the user might be puzzled why they can't store files in public. It's because they've used all their space in their My Documents.
Yeah, yeah.
Basically. So again, we're looking at a decent design. The other bad thing is you can only restrict based on users or globally.
Right.
I can't say, right, salespeople can have this, marketing people can have this.
You can't
do that. This, as ever, Microsoft, what they do is they look at something and say, well, quoting would be a good thing to pile in. So they buy it off someone else and have a cut-down version of it.
Yeah.
And it's exactly what they did with Disk Keeper Lite and the disk defragmentation
tool. You need to buy a more advanced tool to be able to break it down
in
complex ways.
So if I click on deny disk space on here, to exceeding their quota limits, then we should see, well, if they are storing about their quota limits, you will see warnings, etc. in here.
Okay.
And this will affect every single user on here unless you're specifically defined in this list. Administrators is specifically assigned with no limit.
Okay.
Otherwise, you'll find out you won't be able to do anything. So what I might decide to do is say, you know what? I want a new entry. I've got a marketing user. They're called guest. And, oh, I don't think I've logged onto the domain properly. And I'm going to say don't limit their disk usage, or let's give them slightly higher, 1 megabyte or 1 gigabyte or something. Again, I'll leave it at that. You get the idea, guys.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's globally is what's on here. Sorry, what's on here. And unless you're specifically assigned in there. Now, it's the quota system is based upon file ownership. So this is important as well, because if you're an administrator and you install something, you own it. So that eats into your quota, and that's another reason why the administrators, as I said, were not limited whatsoever.
Okay.
Right. Now, there are some other nice things you can do in here. For example, let's say one of the administrators actually leaves. You can go to quote or the guest actually leaves, I won't tell it for administrator, we can go to delete quota entry. Are you sure you want to do that? And unfortunately, that user didn't have any files. But if that user did have any files on that drive, it would say, okay, you want to delete that quota entry. The guest has got some files. What do you want to do with those files? And you can copy them to somewhere else. So that's really nice if you get a user who leaves the organisation. You can delete their account and just get all their stuff off the public and put it somewhere else.
Yeah.
So that's a thing you can do.
Useful in the real world.
Yeah, no, it's quite good. So that's looking at quotering. You okay on that, Nick?
Yep, I think that's pretty good. Yeah, I'm happy with that.
So we've just done disk quotas. Let's have a look at the print queues next. Now, when you add a printer to your machine, and what I'm going to do is just quickly add a printer to my workstation. So let's add a printer. Click on next. In this case, obviously, it depends what physical printer you've actually got. I'm just going to lie and say it's a local printer attached to the machine. But one thing I do want to do is say don't detect it. Okay, so it's a local printer. Port one's fine. And I'm going to go with that driver. And let's share it out as AGFA. Again, that's fine. So the print queue. How do I see the print queue? Just double click on this and you'll see this effectively is the print queue. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pause printing on this because obviously we don't actually have a printer in here. And I'm just going to print some stuff and send that across to the queue. So let's just run Notepad. Notepad. And let's just type something in and just do file and print. And let's print it across to the default printer, which is one I just installed, and we can see that in there. So if I just print that off another time, you'll see. Oops. That effectively is the queue. Now, you might have a problem when this queue, or one of the items in the print queue is having troubles being printed, so it's holding up everything else. Yep. It typically happens when someone prints it to the wrong, you know, paper type, like landscape or, you know, false cap paper instead of A4. So what you can do is you can just right-click and you can cancel jobs.
Yeah.
Okay. The other thing you can do with troubleshooting a printer is let's say that printer has just run out of ink,
mm-hmm.
and you're thinking, Jesus, it's run out of ink, and there's loads of things waiting in the job, or waiting in the queue. What you can do is just go to printer and say pause printing.
Pause all printing.
Sort out the problem, and then you know send it across. There's other really clever things you can do. So I can actually go to the properties of that printer. Again, I don't think they're going to go this far. And you can go to ports and say, hang on a second, this printer isn't on port one, it's on this port, and you specify UNC to a different printer. And that way people are printing to this one and it's redirecting across to another printer.
Okay.
So you can do some really clever things in Windows printing. And you do use Windows printing even with IP printing.
Yeah.
Because what you generally want is you want your Windows server to be a print server.
Yeah.
Because it can spool more. It's mm-hmm. going to have a lot more capacity then. Your standard TCP/IP print device. Okay, so that's just looking at printers. There's nothing really else we can add to there. It's fairly straightforward. You've got pause. And one thing you might get in the exam, if you do have a problem with a printer, one of the exam options is to restart the spool service as a solution to this. And I have seen that as that is actually correct. If you look at Microsoft, they do say, yeah, if you have a problem, restart it. Restart the spool service. The next thing we're going to do is just come back and have a look at performance monitor. And we're looking in particular how we can find bottlenecks in that server,
right.
in any given server. Now, of course, there's a bit of an art to this and it will come with time, but there's four components in a server and in your workstations, in your desktop machines, that have an impact on the overall running of your server. And they're all sort of linked up. So you've got the memory, you've got the network, you've got processor, and you've got disks.
Right.
Now, if you have a look at any one of those, and let's say we have a look at the disks and we think, Jesus, the disk is really busy. Let's get a quicker disk. You can't come to the decision by just looking at one of these things. You need to look at all of them because they all have a knock-on effect.
It's a cooperative environment. All these things have an impact upon the other.
Exactly. I mean, give you an example. If my server only had, let's say, 128 meg of RAM, Well, that's not much, is it?
Well, it's going to be thrashing all the time on the disk.
Exactly. So that's going to drive the disk performance object sky high. So you might look at it and think, oh, God, I need bigger disks. Or no, quicker disks. When if you're monitoring the memory, you'll find things, a specific counter called page faults will be quite high or slowly increasing. Likewise, you might look at the processor and think, oh, Jesus, the processor is high. Why is that? And it might be the same reason. The processor is high because you've got no memory, so the processor is driving the disks, you know, to start swapping these things out. Solution to that, you might think, well, let's buy a disk that can work independently to the processor.
Yeah.
When really, that wasn't the cause of the problem. So all of these go hand in hand together.
So it can be a bit of a cascading effect of problem.
Exactly, yeah. Now, in the Microsoft exam, they do take, or you need to be aware of some specific counters, which I'll take you through.
Okay.
And they do talk about some specific thresholds, which you should be under or should be below. Again, this is a CRAM session, and our job is to prepare you for what Microsoft want you to know.
Yeah.
But certainly, on your real server environment, you might look at these things and that.
Okay.
It doesn't matter because, to be honest, in a real server environment, you design your server, you take a baseline, and any deviations from that baseline, you know, you're wandering into a change.
Yes.
You know, whereas you can't just say, "Oh, the processor is higher than 85%; it's causing a problem."
No. Well,
that might be done by design. I'm not saying it would because it wouldn't be, but you get the point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm just going to one of my servers, Cram SRV01, and I've just pre-prepared some performance consoles just to save us a bit of time. And the first set of objects we're looking at, or the first object we're looking at, is looking at the memory. So there's a few counters which we should be aware of, and the first one is available bytes. Now, do remember when you add these things, they all have an explain button, so it's probably worth it if you're not familiar with it, just playing around with the tool. So the first thing we can see is available bytes, and they say an acceptable range on that is should be, well, above 20 megabytes. So they say more than 20 megabytes you should have available. If not, you know, then there's a problem with the available memory in your server. Next one, committed bytes. Committed bytes is the amount of memory that's actually being used. Okay. Now, if I'm running multiple applications on this server, now some of, let's say I'm running SQL Server and Exchange. If I'm run SQL for a little while, then that information will be paged off to free up some more physical memory. But the committed bytes is the total of what's being used, whether it's being paged or not.
Oh, okay.
So if you look at your committed bytes, and your committed bytes on here are higher than the amount of physical memory, then you know it's giving us an indication that we haven't got much physical memory. Right, page faults per second. Page faults per second, this is all to do again with paging. If an application is running, and it needs to access some of its memory, it wants to find that memory in physical RAM. If that memory has been paged off, then that generates something called a page fault.
Yeah.
And that information has to be dragged from the page file back into physical memory.
Yeah.
So that's a page fault. Now, you do get page faults. And again, with Microsoft and the page faults per second, what they're saying is that should be lower than 5. But again, if you've got a server running in reality, when it's designed, if it's running correctly with 10 page faults per second, that will become a baseline, and you only trigger off if you deviate from that baseline. But from an exam point of view, that needs to be 5 page faults per second. Shouldn't be
higher greater, than 5.
Shouldn't be higher than 5. Right, pages per second. Pages per second. When you're looking at this one, you're looking at just a general rise in pages per second, and this gives you long-term trends.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at your pages per second, and you find after a month it's slowly rising and rising and rising, that's giving us an indication that you know we're using a lot more memory. Then what you could do is you could actually monitor the process to find out what process is generating all of those. And the last one is non-paged bytes. Well, they say if the non-page byte slowly increases, that's an indication of an application which has been written not very well, and it's subject to something called memory leakage.
Yeah.
Okay, where it allocates memory, but it never where it never deallocates memory. You see this a lot, funny enough, on NetWare 3. And they used to recommend you reboot the server every 100 days on that just to get around memory leakage. So, you know, Novell used to suffer from it as well. So we're just looking at that. We're looking for any steady increase, and that's the memory counters. So what I'm going to do is just close that down. Let's go into the next one, which is process, and looking at some of the processor counters. Now, do remember that these things, they are, as we said, meaningless if you look at them independently from one another. So when we have a look at the processor, the first counter we're looking at is, from the processor, the percentage processor time. And again, remember, you've got report views and all of it here, so we can have a look at what the percentage processor time in here. And funnily enough, I'm not that busy at the moment. Okay, and what they're saying, the percentage processor time should be less than 85%. Okay, it should always be less than 85%, because to be honest, if your server's running higher than that...
I was going to say, that's still pretty high, even 85% these days.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, servers generally, you know, you're looking at, you know, figures of close to 10% that they're running at, because you've got to allow for peaks and stuff.
Yeah.
Right, interrupts per second. Now, interrupts per second, there's no art to this one. It does depend on the processor. Basically, an interrupt is when the hardware component just interrupts and says, look, I need serving. Okay, a very basic explanation of it.
Yeah.
And what we're looking for here is we're looking for figures rising. So over time, is it rising? That's indicating a problem. Right, next up, you've got queue length. Now, you've got two similar ones here. You've got queue length, then you've got processor queue length. Now, the processor queue length is an indication of the amount of threads that are waiting to be served. That should be lower than 10.
Okay.
Okay. Processor queue length is processes waiting to be served. Now, a process might divide it up into many threads.
Yeah.
And on here, we're looking for a value that's lower than 4.
Okay.
Okay, so that should be lower than 4. If it's higher then it's an indication that there's a problem. Okay, so the next one we're looking at is disks. Now, to monitor your disks, you can monitor physical disks or logical disks.
Okay.
It really does depend what you're looking at. Now, if you monitor a physical disk and have a look at the amount of bytes sent and received to that physical disk, it's not interested in the volumes or partitions on that disk. It's just looking at it as it, you know, a total to that disk.
Yeah.
So if you monitor logical or physical, you get the same results. You just need to interpret them in a slightly different way. I'm monitoring logical disk, and one thing I actually got incorrect in the ITIdiots podcast is I said you need to run a disk perf minus y command to activate these counters. That was true of older versions. You don't anymore.
Okay.
So no disk perf minus y. Don't need to run it. They're all enabled by default. So all this one's actually doing something here, isn't it? So percentage disk time here, the amount of time that the disk is actually being served. Now, they're saying this figure should be lower than 50%. 50% of the time your disk shouldn't be accessed.
Yeah.
Now, if it is, that could be what could it be an indicator of? Could be an indicator of low system memory, couldn't it?
Because we're
thrashing quite a lot.
Very, very badly defragged drives.
It could be that as
fragmented,
well.
Very heavily fragmented drives.
It could just be, you know, slow disks. It could be slow disk subsystem. Right, average disk bytes transfer. Now these ones, the average disk bytes per transfer and the disk bytes per second, this is information that you need to take up and weigh up with the physical specifications of the hard disk or the SAN or whatever you're using.
Yeah.
Because no one can tell you, I can't say, right, all your bytes per second is high, you need to sort that out, because I need to weigh that up against the physical specifications of the drive.
Okay.
So those two ones are quite easy. The current disk queue length is the amount of things waiting to be written to the drive. Now again, what from a Microsoft point of view, they say that should be in the region of 0 to 2. If you've got more things being queued up, what you can do is get yourself a fast disk subsystem, or, you know, have multiple drives.
Break things out.
Use RAID 5. But again, you can see this might all be might be a memory problem causing all of this.
Yeah.
So that's looking at the disk subsystem. Okay, next off, we're looking at network. Now, the network one, again, this one's quite straightforward, because if you look at the counters, we're monitoring bytes received per second, bytes total per second, bytes sent per second. This is figures which you need to weigh up with, again, the specifications of your physical network and also your network card.
Mm.
So the only thing you can do here is weigh up, again, against the manufacturer's specifications. You never get the manufacturer's specifications, so be realistic. But again, reality-wise, you're just looking for changes from your baseline.
Mm.
So you create a baseline, you record the figures of, or you record these settings when it's not work under normal operations, that becomes your baseline, and any rise in that or drop in that would indicate a problem. You know, a drop could be a server's down. And that's really it for performance. So that was a really cram on that one. So have a look at those counters, guys. Add them in, create yourself a console, and check on the explain button.
Okay.
Have a look at it. But yeah, you'll get a lot of questions right from looking at those counters. Right, the next off is looking at managing a web server. Now, this is not going to be very thorough in this exam because it's not an IIS exam. But again, what you're expected to know is the administration tools. You're expected to know the authentication levels. So what we're going to do is we're going to step through the IIS administration tool and look at the authentication levels and sort of understand those. So I'm going to pop into my server here. I've installed IIS on it. So if I just load up the IIS manager, let's just have a look at this. Now this tool, just like Computer Manager, we can use to connect to remote IIS machines. So we can have one admin tool focused on lots of IIS machines. At the moment, I've just got Cram SRB01. We can see it's a local computer. And if I go into websites, we can see I've just got my one default website running there. So when you install IIS, you just get nothing really. You just get a blank website.
Get the start page.
Exactly. Or under construction, I think, isn't it? So what I'm going to do is go to the properties of this website, and let's talk through some of the important configuration options on this website. Okay, so just the name of it, description, and the IP addresses that it's operating on. So on a web server, you might have two interfaces, and you might have dedicate one interface for web traffic and the other for some other type of traffic, so you can subdivide that. You've got connection timeout in there, so it's for keeping your browser connected to the server. And you've got logging information down here, excuse me. You can log directly in IIS file format as well, and that seems to be one of the ones you would use if you want to use IIS to have a look at those counters. Right, as I said, what I'm going to do is pick on some of the important counters. And this one might be quite interesting if you don't know anything about IIS or haven't had much exposure to it. If you go to the website, i.e. go to the CRAMS SRV01 HTTP to it, what it will do is it will present you with what's in that folder in the local path, CNAP, INETPUB, www.root. Okay, so what it's doing is it's looking in there, and it's looking for any one of these. Now, notice when you go to a website, you don't say go to itiditiots.com/index.htm, because the web server on it will look for some default content pages. So look for a default in here, and I think it hits that one, because these ones don't exist inside that particular folder. Now, if we look at security next, directory security. First off, we have got the ability to make this as an SSL site, so we can put a certificate on this web server, and that way everything will be signed. Mm-hmm. The certificate that's on this web server would have to be trusted by the people who are going to access this web server. So if people from the if this was a public web server, the certificate on it would have to be signed by
generated by third party.
Third party like VeriSign, or I think it's BTDirt or Thought.
RapidSSL.
Exactly. Now, if you're setting up an intranet site, and this is where lots of people lose the plot, I feel, if you're setting up an intranet site, this is for people inside your company, and you want to use SSL, well, the certificate needs to come from someone that they trust.
Self-generate.
Exactly. You could self-generate one, put a certificate server in your environment, but we'll get onto that in one of the other Cram sessions. So we can use SSL in there, that's no problem. You can also restrict based on IP address. Mm-hmm. So I could say only if you're in the 192.168.1 subnet can you access this, and that would be, you know, basically saying you need to be within the intranet, so you can't come in from anywhere else. So we've got various security options in there. But what I want to do is go through the authentication control. Okay. Now, normally when you access a web server, you don't authenticate to it. So if I access this machine, I'm not going to authenticate. However, to Windows, you've always got to authenticate. You can't just say, I'm not going to authenticate. So whenever you set up IIS, it sets up this user account on the local machine called iusr_cram_srv01_machine_name.
Yeah.
Now, this is the anonymous user. So if you access the website, you don't log on, you're treated to Windows as this user account. So yeah. That user needs to have access to the default.htm tab, etc. And it's really nice, because what you can do is you can put NTFS permissions on files on your website, and it will pop up a box asking you to authenticate if you try and access a file which that user hasn't got access to.
Yeah.
However, in my case, it won't, because the only type of authentication I'm allowing is anonymous.
Yeah.
What I would need to do there is also say, well, I could get integrated Windows authentication. Now, integrated Windows authentication, this would be useful if this was an intranet site, because it takes the username and password you've already logged on as, i.e. you've logged onto the domain in the morning, and it passes that through, so you're authenticated that way. So this is useful for an internal website. However, let's say I want to use this for a web server to gain access to my email. Mm-hmm. Okay, so an Outlook web access server. So if I'm in the outside world, I log onto my local machine as, let's say, Nikki, the password's password, but it certainly doesn't match my domain account.
No.
So for me, that wouldn't work. Accessing the outside, you would have to do basic authentication.
Yeah.
Now, as soon as you specify basic authentication, it pops up this message, because basic authentication is clear text. Mm-hmm. Okay, so clear text, my username and password will be sent from home to that IIS machine in clear text. However, what you can do is make it an SSL website.
Yeah.
In which case, it's clear text over an SSL.
Over SSL.
And that's exactly why most of you, if you're running out of web access, it will be basic, but you'll be using SSL on it as well, just to sort of encrypt that traffic. So that's that. The other thing you've got is digest authentication. Now, digest authentication is, well, it's sort of new-ish. It's RFC version of, well, some people say it's like an RFC cross between integrated and basic. It's open, so integrated is Windows only, but it gives us high, it gives us high security in that the authentication information is not passed across in clear text.
It's encrypted.
It's encrypted, yeah. So it's like encrypted authentication, but not encrypted tunnel. That would be SSL.
Yeah.
The last one down the bottom, net password authentication, they've withdrawn that. No support for that anymore.
Not quite really?
Yeah, not quite sure. Yeah, the idea is what you could do is you could type your web server with .net.
Yeah.
So you could say, oh, nicky.hurst@hotmail.com. He can access it, so you could do that.
Yeah.
Never really happened. Some of the popular ones you see on here are basic.
They ran it for a while on their MSDN, didn't they?
Yeah, the concept of passports is sort of kind of gone, unless you're accessing Microsoft sites now.
Yeah.
But you used to be able to use it for eBay, use your passport.
That's right.
Okay, so that's probably as much as you need to know on IIS, so looking at the management of it and the security of it. Okay. And that leaves us one thing at the bottom, which is looking at software updates, the software update infrastructure. Now, software update infrastructure, we're not going to demo this one to you because literally it would take too long. And we have got a quite a good WSUS episode on ITIdiots. So what I'm going to do is sort of assume you know a little bit about it, as this is a Cram session, and just talk about how WSUS actually works.
Okay.
So if you've got an organisation, let's say it consists of 100 client machines, the problem with those client machines now is, well, they require patching on a fairly regular basis.
Yeah.
So we've got a couple of ways we could deal with that. We could get all of those clients to go to Windows update site and pull them all down, but that's going to hammer my internet connection.
Yep.
So what I might decide to do is put inside my network a Windows update server. Now that Windows update server, its job really is to go out to the Microsoft update site, bring down a catalog to that server that contains a list of all the updates. And then what we'd have to do with a group policy is you have to tell your clients to look at that catalog and they identify what's missing. On WSUS, the benefit there is we can then have a look at what clients are requesting. You'll be able to see quite clearly on the console, look, there's 50 clients that are actually requesting this update. After investigating that update and testing it, you right-click and approve it. It automatically downloads from the update site to the local WSUS server, and then it can be deployed out to the client machines.
Bringing benefits of being able to test it before then deploying it amongst a large network.
Exactly, yeah. So WSUS is the way to go. And when you look at the syllabus, they're still talking about software update services, which is long gone now. So they're not going to test you on that. It's all going to be WSUS based. But check out the WSUS podcast. It, it's quite straightforward. But it just gives you centralised control of your updates.
It does.
That's what it does.
It really does.
Okay, excellent. And that's end of part 4.
Excellent. That sounds really good.
Okay, see you in part 5.
Thank you.